Well, it's Big Wednesday night. You often hear me say it, or I say it often, and that is, I love Big Wednesday night. It's miracles, 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 miracles. You know, Apostle Paul said these words, "Covet ye earnestly the best gifts." One of the nine spiritual gifts is miracles. And that is what we are believing God for you on this Big Wednesday night. I'm excited. I'm excited. And the miracles. I just wish that we had capabilities of bringing you every miracle, every miracle. You're going to hear me. You're going to hear me give two specific miracles that has happened in the month of May. You're also going to hear from a couple of individuals in the live services of miracles that are happening. It is amazing. Between Passover or Easter and Pentecost in this 50-day period, how the visitation of Jesus Christ is appearing with miracles. And tonight we're going to pray for you. We're going to believe God for you. And when we go into the service, let your expectations really rise. I want to encourage you, the last Wednesday night, Perry Stone. Now, I want to tell you that Perry has not been traveling. He kind of took off for COVID, has not been traveling, and he is opening up his schedule right here on Wednesday night. A week, 2 weeks from tonight, Perry Stone will be here on the last Wednesday night of May. Talked to Jensen Franklin. He won't be here tonight, but it looks like he'll be here next Wednesday night. So the last two Wednesday nights are just going to be phenomenal. And tonight I've come with my faith. I have a word from the Lord, the second touch, the second anointing. When Jesus touched the blind man, one of the blind people that he healed in the New Testament, he asked him, "Can you see?" And the Bible said, he said, "I see men like trees." In other words, Jesus said, "Come here, let me touch you again." There is a second touch anointing that's going to happen. So if the miracle is not clear or it hasn't come through, then tonight it's going to be cleared up. That's what we're believing. That's what we're speaking. And that's what we are going to pray for you about. Get everybody you possibly can to watch, to be a part. Call them, whatever you got to do. Focus in. This will be a night of miracles, Wednesday night. I'm so excited about what God's doing. Just in a few weeks, we have Pentecost Sunday. I believe that's June 4th. First Sunday in June. That's going to be so wonderful for us to experience Pentecost Sunday, the birthday of the church, and the blessings of God. So I'm excited about tonight. So let's go into the service. Let's get our praise and our worship. Just get ready for great things to happen. All of you that want jobs or needing a better job, or bring your applications, send your applications in, we're believing that God is going to do that. Let's go into the service for the Big Wednesday night. Miracles in May.
Center, welcome to our Wednesday night service. I hope you come expecting for God to do something amazing. Let's stand up to our feet. Get ready to worship God together. Come on.
Yes, Lord. We believe that breakthrough is coming. We believe that miracles are going to happen tonight, Lord. We believe that where there is no way, you're going to make a way. God, we worship and we praise you tonight, Father. We just take a moment to lift our hands tonight, church. Let's worship together. Thank you, Jesus.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in darkness. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship. I worship.
Come on, church, let me hear your voice tonight.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise king, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
We lift our voices and say you are the way maker.
Way maker, miracle worker, promise king, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working.
Come on, let's sing that in faith tonight. Even when.
Even when I don't see it. Even when I don't feel it, you're working.
Never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Even when the doctor says there's nothing I can do.
Even when I.
Even when my bank account said no,
you never stop working,
Lord.
You never stop.
You never stop working, Lord. Even when my faith took over, even when the walls wouldn't come down,
you never stop,
Lord.
You never stop. You never stop working.
You never stop.
You never stop working.
You never stop.
You never stop working.
You never stop.
You never stop working.
Continue with our worship. We're at the time where we get to declare a truth from His Word found in 3 John 2. So let's read it out aloud together and believe it. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. So I just have the privilege of praying for our prosperity. And Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you that you are a way maker. Father, that you are a miracle worker. And so, Lord Jesus, I pray for every single person that is listening, those that are tuning in online, those that are here in person, those that are going to be watching this at a later time. Father God, I pray that you would just bless them with a fresh anointing of expectation of for you to move in ways that they have never seen you move before. Father God, I just pray that you would open doors. Father, that you would guide them, Father God, with your Holy Spirit, Father. Lord, I pray that you would just give them the trust and the faith, Father God, to believe you. Father, increase our faith, Lord Jesus, to know that you are the God of the impossible. And Lord Jesus, there is no lack or want with your children. So Lord Jesus, I pray that you would provide, that you would open the windows of heaven over every single person that is listening, Lord Jesus. We thank you in advance for the miracles that are coming, the miracles that are just to the glory of your name. For Father, you love and delight to provide for your children. So we thank you in advance, and we give you thanks and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
How many are excited you're part of the greatest church this side of heaven? Amen. We got the greatest pastor on the planet. He has a word for you tonight. It's going to change your life forever. He's taught us that miracles are something God creates especially just for you. And a healing is when God restores something just for you. So let's believe him right now. Wonderful Lord, we thank you. Wonderful Jesus, we sense your presence in this place. We thank you for Family Christian Center. It's been a great part of my life for many, many years. We ask God that you would touch every life in this house. May we not leave the way we came. Touch, heal, restore, heal sick bodies, sort out mind problems and monsters. In Jesus' name, I declare everyone in the sound of my voice to be absolutely healed and restored in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen. And at this time, we're going to pray for your soul, that your soul may prosper. You know, our soul is made up of three parts. That's our mind, our will, and our emotions. So, gracious Father, right now, oh Lord, Lord, we want to align our soul, oh Lord, oh Father, with your spirit and with your word, oh Lord. Lord, we align our will, oh Father, with your will, oh Lord. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, O Lord. Lord, let your will be done in our lives, O Father God. Lord, that you go in, O Father God, and do your work, O Lord. Lord, that we submit unto your will, O Father, that we lead and we guide, O Lord. We give our wills up for your will, O Father. Lord, and we ask, O Lord, that you heal our minds, O Lord, that our minds are strengthened, O Lord. Lord, that our minds are focused, O Lord, just as your mind was focused on the purpose, O Lord. Lord, that we love, O Lord, as you love, O Father God. Lord, that our minds are healed, O Lord, and we bind every spirit, every emotion, O Lord, every feeling, O Lord, that's trying to cloud our minds. We pull down and cast down those imaginations that try to rise up above your word, O Lord. But your word, O Lord, goes forth, O Father God, that you will do the work, O Lord, in our soul, that our souls will prosper, that we will have success going in and out of the city, O Lord, that we will be productive for your will and for your kingdom. In Jesus' mighty name, we thank you for healing and prospering our soul. In Jesus' mighty name, we say amen. Amen, 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 amen. Thank you.
Who you are, oh, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light.
For jobs, as we sing this song, bring them right down here. We're going to believe for prosperity.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper,
have your job application and you're in the audience, come down right now. We'll believe in God. Everybody stretch your hands toward every application and say, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Prosperity.
Prosperity.
Blessings.
Blessings.
Are coming.
Are coming.
Upon every applicant.
Upon every applicant.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Now every person that is here, if you want to go higher in your job, if you want better pay, if you want something to happen, if you're a student and need a job, bring those applications. We have not because we ask not. And so when we make this appeal, we are making it and presenting it to God. Because when you give it to God, how many knows He will open up the door? He will open up the way. Now, if you don't need any more money, you're satisfied with what you're doing in life, that's great. May God multiply. May God bless you. But this is an appeal for everyone that desires the dream. A dream and to believe that God can do impossible things. Amen?
Amen.
So everybody say, God.
God.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Everyone.
Everyone.
Of these applicants.
Of these applicants.
Let's all take a step of faith and believe by May 30th. By May 30th. Or tomorrow morning. That in the name of Jesus, there's going to be miracles for every application that has been brought. There's going to be miracles that are going to happen. Financial conditions are going to change. And God is going to do mighty miracles in the name of Jesus. And everybody say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Now, before you're seated, everybody here, everybody watching, it's important tonight that we stay in the dimension of believing for miracles. We all here, and I invite everyone watching or even here in attendance, I want you to believe that miracles, everybody say miracles.
Miracles.
The gift of miracles, just say that with me, the gift of miracles.
The gift of miracles.
And I'll show you in scripture in just a moment that the gift of miracles, that it is activated over this congregation, over everyone that is in this house. So everybody, this is very biblical. This is very biblical. I'll show you. I'm going to show you something in a minute. It's very biblical that Apostle Paul teaches us in the book of Corinthians to covet earnestly the best gift. So tonight, in this service, in this atmosphere, we're coveting, in the name of Jesus, the miraculous. The miraculous. The miraculous. What is the miraculous? The miraculous is something you cannot do. The miraculous is something man cannot do. Now, if you can fix your problem, that's not a miracle. But if you can't fix it and you want God to do a miracle, then let's step in together. Everybody say this, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Let miracles,
let miracles
be upon us.
Be upon us.
The supernatural.
The supernatural.
We step into the supernatural.
We step into the supernatural.
With our faith.
With our faith.
To believe.
To believe.
For the impossible.
For the impossible.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Everybody, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Now what's going to happen in the next few minutes, everybody? Something you can't do. Something you cannot do. I'm praying will be released upon you that the spirit and the gift of miracles. So everybody say, I covet.
I covet.
Earnestly this gift.
Earnestly this gift.
Impossible things.
Impossible things.
Things that have not yet happened.
Things that have not yet happened.
In my life.
In my life.
God.
God.
Is about to do miracles.
Is about to do miracles.
In the next 60 minutes.
In the next 60 minutes.
That will change the rest of my life.
That will change the rest of my life.
Can your faith believe that by giving them a hand clap? Just, I believe that. I'm stepping into the gift of miracles. Stepping into the gift of miracles. Stepping into the gift of miracles. All right, now get full of anticipation. Turn to somebody and say, tonight the gift of miracles is upon you. Say that to somebody. The gift of miracles is upon you. And you may be seated. Watch this.
With World Vision's annual Global 6K. Have you registered yet? When you do that, they will send you everything that you need for the 6K. So your t-shirt, as well as your race bib. And on each bib will be a photo of the young person that you will be sponsoring for the 6K. This is my little one right here, and I will be representing the country of Lesotho, which is in southeastern Africa. We are so excited. This is an event for the entire family. We can't wait to see you. For more information, then you can meet me in the lobby right after service.
The reason why I wouldn't bring Jensen in tonight is because everybody is not here. And if you expect me to bring in somebody that's high anointed and I tell you that somebody is coming, don't play with me. Or I'm going to ask God for it to snow next Wednesday 2 feet deep. Because if a little heat keeps everybody away from church, my goodness, that's absolutely terrible. This is the month of miracles. We prayed and fasted. Thank you for responding. But I'm not going to bring great gifts into this church. If you don't respect the gifts, then we shouldn't ask the gifts to come. Now, Perry Stone is coming the last Wednesday of this month, scheduled to be here. Jensen said to me yesterday, I'll come next week if you really want me to come. But I'm not going to bring him in. You won't embarrass me. I'll go to his church. You get somebody to be a guest speaker next Wednesday night. I'll preach there. Don't you do that. Don't you do that. You tell, now you all are faithful, but you need to tell the other people that. And everybody shout a great big amen.
Amen.
Church is church. Miracles are miracles. And if you're bored with me, just tell me. We'll shut down Wednesday night. I can go any place in America. And I can preach to thousands of people, but I'm not going to preach to people that are going to say, it don't matter if I come and it's 90 degree weather, so I don't know if I should come or not. Make up in your mind if you want a miracle, you got to go after a miracle, all right? That's a very important. That's important to me. That should be important to everyone. Everyone that is a part of this community. And of course, all of you are faithful. I'm discipling you to tell them. And if you want me to, you just bring them to me and I'll tell them myself.
Let me talk about miracles before I start praying and share a few miracles with you tonight. It is very scriptural, very, very scriptural, that miracles happen in the body of Christ or as you as a believer. It is very, very scriptural. The 12th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Everybody say 1 Corinthians. That is a book in the Bible in the New Testament. It is, you will find that there is the book of Acts, there's Romans, and Corinthians. This is a church in Corinth. Corinthians is Corinth. These letters, these scriptures are not only for Corinth, but they are for Munster, Chicago, Los Angeles, Cherryville, Linwood. And you will notice that the scriptures and the edification of the Word of God, if you get this, life can be so much easier when you come up against struggles that happen in your life. Now, let me paraphrase to tell you that what I'm about to tell you has been silenced in a lot of parishes, churches, and synagogue. I do not know why. I do not know why the argument is about that it is no longer for us. I don't get it. We'd be glad to debate priest, pastor, reverend, doctor, bishop, archbishop, whoever might bear the title of wanting to discuss scriptures to say that miracles do not no longer happen today. And there is a segment of religion, huge denominations, people you watch on television that will tell you quickly if you get them in a corner that miracles are really not for us today. It was for the church then, but not for us today. You will find a segment of believers that say, we do not speak in tongues. That is not for us today. That was for them back there, but not for us. Easily they use the scripture verses that tongues has ceased, and it did not mean that at all. It only meant that for understanding of the unbeliever when you begin to study the principles of the powerful gifts that God has given us. So consequently, many people struggle in church people, believer people. They don't have a minister that will lay hands upon them. The Bible said they shall lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. Aren't you glad you go to a church that says, let us lay hands on you and we believe that you will recover? It'd be terrible to go to a church and you say to the pastor, would you lay hands on me? And he says, well, we don't do that here. We don't believe in that. We'll pray for you, but we don't follow that because it no longer happens. I'm not here to bring up debate or discord, but I will tell you that you have a strong percentage of people who no longer believe that speaking in tongues is for us today, that the gifts of the spirits are for us today. The same people do not believe that there are apostles, and they don't believe in prophets. They don't have any in their church. They don't exercise that. And I'm not trying to bring disqualification, nor am I trying to bring discord or debate within the body of Christ. But I just want you to note, all of you that are here tonight, you are in an atmosphere, you are in a church that believes in divine healing. I believe in divine healing. The Bible speaks of it. I would not do it just because it's a cute thing to do, but it's very, very biblical. It's a biblical principle. God has given it to us. The same group of people that do not believe in speaking in tongues, they do not believe in the gifts of the Spirit, which I'll go through just real quick, and they do not believe that is for us today. Those same people would argue with you to say to say that the beating that Jesus took on his back, that most of us know about, a scene when the Bible says by his stripes we are healed, those same constituents, those same people who call themselves Protestants and believers, and sometimes in Catholicism, they will tell you when it comes down to divine healing, they will tell you they do not believe that by his stripes on his back is in the atonement, which the atonement is Jesus dying on the cross for the sins of humanity. And you will find, if you become scholastic and begin to do a survey, you will be shocked at even people you know who are believers. They do not practice divine healing. They do not practice anointing. They do not practice believing for miracles. And if they're scholastically sharp enough, they can get you in a debate and will try to prove to you that the back of Jesus Christ is not in the atonement when he died at Calvary. I differ with that because I believe that being healed by his stripes is in the atonement of the cross of Jesus Christ. Now, if you don't understand that, you need scripture to verify that. You journey through the Bible, study, and you will come up with the same conclusion that Jesus, when he died for your sins, he also paid the price for you to be healed. For you to be healed. It does not mean we will not get sick. It does not mean that we will not die physically. But when sickness comes into our body, Jesus paid the price by taking the stripes upon his back. It is for healing. It is an insult when someone says, I don't believe in divine healing, when he was beaten like a lamb led to the slaughter and took upon the pain and the agony to heal any believer that will believe in him, he will heal them. And I'm so glad I go to a church that believes in divine healing. And I'm going to tell you, as long as I am the senior pastor, I'm going to fight for your health. I don't care if you're dying on the bed and the doctor tells me they don't have long to live. It's not my responsibility to agree with the negative talk. I must agree with the Bible. I'll go in and pray like they're going to be raised up out of that bed. And you say, but wonder if they die in the next 5 minutes. I still have a responsibility as a believer to not agree with negativity, but to agree that you are healed. Now let me show you something. Nobody is going to heaven sick. For those that are going to heaven, now you that are going to hell, take your sickness with you, I guess. But if you're going to heaven, you're going to be healed. When does the healing atonement happen? It has to happen on this side. Because when you get over there, we're completely changed. We don't know what we shall be, but we know when he shall appear, we should be like him. So when I'm praying for somebody that's dying, on the death certificate, they may say they died because of this. But when prayer is made and they are a believer, who says that when they died, God did not heal them before they went to the other side? I've walked in many, many situations. If you ask me to your house and you say, please come and pray for my father, my mother, they're dying, this is their last day, you're gonna see me come in. I do this all the time. Everybody's crying, everybody's got a box of Kleenex, everybody's, oh, this is it, this is daddy, mama, and I walk in and say, well, how you doing? This is a great day. Because people who are, you think, unconscious, in a coma, don't hear you, they got oxygen, they got tubes, and they can't correspond with you, their spirit is very, very strong.
You don't walk in and harmonize with, oh, poor you, oh, my God, it's terrible, what's going on? You walk in with faith and begin to say, God's going to do a miracle. God is going to heal you. God, that's the way we believers should respond. Now, it doesn't mean that we don't cope with reality. You say, but it's really real. They're going to die. Well, praise God. If they're a believer, then we should be rejoicing around the bed. Look at, wait. Look at everybody. What do you mean rejoicing around that? If we actually understood that Jesus took the sting out of death and took the keys away from Satan, if we understood the resurrection power, which is a difficult challenge for any human being, you would understand that Jesus won't even give a minute, a second to death. He wouldn't even go to John the Baptist's funeral, who he said was the greatest prophet that ever lived. Why? He will not tolerate death. He'll look at you and say, there's no death in Sting. There's no grave in the victory. I came to destroy death. I am the resurrection. Now you're probably thinking, well, Pastor, are you trying to tell us that we ought to change our culture and change our tearful and shouldn't be sad? Oh, no, we're going to have that moment in which we're going to feel the departing, and we are emotional people. But if you understand the resurrection, you can walk up to mama who may be dying. Tears are running down your face, and you love her, but at the same time, you're smiling because where she's going, don't you remember? Don't you remember what Jesus did? He was dying. Jesus was dying trying to carry his cross. He was bleeding. He was dying. He fell underneath the cross. He couldn't carry it any longer. He was dying. Before he got to the top of the skull, before they put nails in his hands, nails in his feet, they had beaten most of the blood out of his body when they scourged him. They had beat him up as the Bible says, a lamb led to the slaughter. He couldn't carry the cross. Truth fell in the streets. His mother gets to him, and he tells his mother, what are you weeping for? Well, you're my baby. You're my firstborn. Look what they're doing to you. You're dying, son. He said to her, don't weep for me. Weep for yourself. I'm getting ready to experience resurrection. Anybody that has Jesus Christ and dies, it's nothing but a graduation exercise into another world. We flower it up, we cry it up, we coffin it up, we cremate it up, we doll it up, we prop death up. And Jesus turned his back and says, I won't have a thing to do with death. Jesus may not show up at your funeral. He'll just meet you at the eastern gate. After you've had a well, I'd like for Jesus to show up and at least cry. He did his crying at Calvary. He did his weeping in the Garden of Gethsemane. He sweat great drops of blood. He took care of the sting of death once and for all. For when death entered into the Garden of Eden, it was his motive for 4,000 years. The secret was kept a mystery. For the Bible said, had the devil known who he was, he would have never crucified him. But Jesus slips into the backside of the earth called Bethlehem through a virgin called Mary, grows up, and at 33 years of age, puts his head on the devil and steals the keys of death. If I die, don't you dare cry. Somebody sing a fast song. Sing my favorite song. Don't moan and groan. Praise God where I am. Look at that. That just goes over like, no, I want more flowers. I want people to moan and groan over me. If you're going to hell, I'll be there to cry. I'm going to cry, cry, cry. I'm going to say sad, sad, sad. Because you not only died, but you'll experience the second death, which is Hades. Okay? We're talking about miracles, healing. So a lot of the Christian world does this in life. People who are believers, nice people who, I go to such and such church, I'm saved, I'm a believer, going to heaven. And they live life this way. This is the way they live. So they get sick or they have a financial situation. They don't know about the power of the Holy Spirit. They have Jesus with them, but they don't have him inside of them. You can have Jesus walk with you, but if he gets inside of you, that's the Holy Ghost. And for all of you that don't want to be on fire, just keep him beside you. But if he gets on the inside of you, there's a power called greater is he. You get him on the inside of you, it's like fire shut up in your bones. You get him on the inside of you, the power of the demonstration of the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. There's a difference. Lots of people, I believe in Jesus. Where is he? Well, he walks with me, talks with me. He's right there by my bed. Well, have you let him in? No, sir, because I don't want to give up my tongue. Because if I speak in tongues, he'll cleanse my tongue of my negative, because I don't want his tongue, I want my own tongue. So you just stay right where you are, religion. You keep your hands to yourself, Jesus, don't put them on me. Now you think that I'm overbearing, but the fact is it is very, very truthful. You go to work tomorrow and ask how many believers went to Wednesday night church and said, do you guys lay hands on the sick and you have miracles at your church? What? Are you crazy? We don't do that no more. They did that in the first church. So the average Christian lives like this when they have a problem. They just, well, I hope God will heal me. Boy, if you do this, you get tired real quick and say, I don't believe in divine miracles either, because, well, it looks like God don't want to do a miracle. So in the book of Corinthians, in the 12th chapter, God says, for all of you that have Jesus on the inside, you've got the Holy Ghost inside of you. He said, brethren, wherefore I give unto you, third verse, understanding that no man speaketh by the Spirit of God called Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. You got the Holy Ghost? You got the Holy Ghost? Then you can say Jesus is Lord. And there are, watch this, when you get the Holy Ghost, there are different administrations, but the same Lord. But the manifestation of the Spirit, which is given to every man, profit withal. Here's what, are you ready? God said, instead of you, hoping someday, Lord, give me wisdom. Lord, give me wisdom. Lord, give me knowledge. Are you a believer? Absolutely, I'm a believer. Has God answered your prayer? Not yet, but I'm sawing it. And so there are 9 spiritual gifts if you have the Holy Spirit. The first one is wisdom. It's a gift. You don't get it in college. You don't get it in high school. It's a gift, automatic gift. You know things that nobody else knows, that nobody else taught you but the Holy Spirit. Is this boring? Is this boring over here? Are you all looking at the ground? Is this boring? Wisdom is an automatic thing. Knowledge. It is a gift. You have the Holy Ghost, God will give you knowledge. It's just supernatural. You just know stuff that nobody, you just, boom. To another faith. Now, this is not the faith. There are several levels of faith. This is not the faith that God gives you when you're born, because the Bible said to every man when you're born, to every man in Romans, is given a measure of faith. How do we increase that faith? Faith cometh by hearing. Great, you've been reading the Bible. Faith cometh by hearing. You can't read the Bible and get faith. You need to quote scriptures. So you hear it, or hear a preacher, or hear somebody quoting it, and it builds your faith. Now that is a faith in which God has given you. Some of you got little faith, big faith, medium-sized faith. I don't know what your level of faith is, okay? But then there is a power gift. There's another faith God gives it to you when you covet it for special things at special times. It's a power gift. Then there's healing, power healing. If your child is sick, you need to ask God, God, give me the gift of healing when I walk into that bedroom. Here's another one. There's 9 of them. To another, the working of miracles. That's what we're doing tonight. This is what's going to happen tonight. Everybody just said amen. It'll happen to you. The rest of you, we'll wait till next week. We'll talk about the second touch. You got to be on go. You can't just sit back, fold arms, and say, well, if it happens, it happens. You got to be on go. I'm covenanted. I'm believing. I want this gift. I want it to operate in my life. That's what he's saying. Faith, healing, miracles. Another one is prophecy. In other words, I could step into the dimension, say, Lord, give me a prophecy. Let me speak something over somebody and let it come to pass. Proceed. Another is discerning of spirits. Boy, you need to have this all the time. Discerning when that boy walks in, he wants to date your daughter. Discerning. Is he a witchcrafter? Is he a drugger? Has he got another woman pregnant? She had an abortion. He's keeping it discerning. Not judging. I'm not talking about judging and putting them on the spot. Just, you ever had that thing come on you? Just something don't feel right. I don't know what it is. I fed him. I fed her. I loved. I was kind to her, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, discerning. Then there is diverse kinds of tongues. Let me just, I won't spend a lot of time on this. I should spend a whole evening on this. Very good. Tongues, when tongues come, when you speak a language, in other words, words you don't understand. When I speak in tongues, I do not understand anything I say. It is edifying to God. It's a language to God. I'll just give you a little commercial here and I'll move on. Everything you pray in English, the devil hears it. But if you have the Holy Ghost and you begin to pray in tongues, now, Pastor, what did you just do? The Spirit maketh intercession. Don't know the word I said, but I just prayed the perfect prayer, and it is a language in which the devil does not understand, and only God. Now, let me break it down. No, let me take you to the number two commercial. Can you take a little more? Put your false teeth in. Adjust your teeth. This is steak. This is not titty. This is steak. This is not milk. You handle this? When God on the seventh day rested, he didn't ask Michael, I need a pillow, I'm exhausted. After Yellowstone and the Great Lakes, Michigan and Erie, and the Atlantic and the Pacific, and the Alps and China and the continents, I am exhausted. Every tree, every flower, every fish, every animal, I am exhausted. I need to rest. That is ignorance. The Bible says God is unsearchable. He never runs out. Then why did the Bible say he rested on the seventh day? Because when you go to Isaiah, the Bible said, with stammering lips and an unknown tongue, I will speak to my people, and this is the rest. In other words, on the seventh day, oh, I'm about to shout here. On the seventh day, God changed languages on the devil. On Monday, he said, then let there be light. On Tuesday, he said, let there be a tree. He spoke everything to in existence. But on the seventh day, he rested. He changed languages. He prophesied his future. What are you talking about, Pastor? For the Bible said, had the devil known who Jesus was, but it was a mystery. It was a secret. Since the foundation of the world. The foundation of the world was in 7 days. And on the seventh day, he changed languages on the devil and created that one day that he, God Almighty, would come through a virgin called Mary. It would be called the Son of the Living God, a God-man and a man-God. For in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Everybody still got your teeth? You're going to have to pick the meat out of your teeth tonight, because this is awful meaty. This is not milky. This is not diaper time. This is not pass out the bottles time. This is some meat. And when God fills you with the Holy Ghost, he lets the devil know you got it. Because your tongue starts speaking things it's never spoke before. Ah! For these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall cast out devils. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall speak with new. Come. So there are different types, different kinds of tongues. We all don't speak the same language. In tongues, it's an edification to God. You ought to try it. Somebody said, do I have to do it? No! You don't have to do it. just keeps on. But be filled with the Spirit of God and let the Spirit maketh intercession, Romans 8. We don't know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit maketh intercession. And besides, it's a gift. And it's everybody's. Just believe it. Anybody done it? Anybody ever done it? And if you haven't done it, then tonight's your night. Or when you get in the shower in the morning, all of a sudden the Holy Ghost is going to hit you and go, oh, bye-bye, what in the world happened to me just in there? Then there's the gift of interpretation of tongues. That's a gift. Now watch this. When you get the Holy Ghost, God gives you 9 gifts, and tonight we're working on the miracle gift. And when you are filled with the Holy Ghost, you go from the saw so you can saw all you want, but I'm going to go after the power gifts of the Holy Ghost. Need somebody to shout hallelujah, clap your hands. Just easy as that. So when I'm up here and I tell you, Joe, put up our chart. This is Journey Through the Bible. Every one of you should have this. This is in Journey Through the Bible. These are the gifts for you. Revelation gifts, discerning spirit, word of knowledge, word of wisdom. Power gifts, gifts of healing, working in miracles, faith. Speaking gifts, divers tongues, interpretation of tongues, prophecy. Prophecy. When I get up here, I want you to know this is all biblical. I'm not up here just trying to psych you out. When I get up here, what does the scripture say? 1 Corinthians 12:31. What does it say? What does it say? What does it say? 1 Corinthians, say, what does it say? But covet earnestly the best gifts. Everybody say, but covet earnestly the best gifts. Live your life. If you're in a business situation, God, give me the revelation gifts. Give me a discerning. Give me a word of knowledge. Give me a word of wisdom. Gifts of healing. Tonight, in the next moment, I am going to believe. We all have agreed to get into the dimension of miracles. This is not some televangelist you saw on television giving out purple water and polka dotted handkerchiefs and all of that. And I'm not going to judge them, but I'm just telling you this is very biblical. And when I tell you that a miracle is going to happen, I am mixing miracles with prophecy, the inspirational gifts. I am speaking with the gift of faith, gifts working to miracles, to believe that every person that is in this house could be that God kept many people away because you were the only ones that were supposed to be here tonight for God to give you a miracle. Okay? Everybody say, I'm supposed to be here. Everybody, I can't hear them that are watching, but everybody say it for them. Say, you're supposed to be watching. Now watch this. I talked tonight that God was going to give you the second touch in this miracle service. So Jesus comes to Bethesda, Mark 8, 22. They bring the blind man to him and besought him to touch him. Okay? I'm going to help you because there might be some in the house. You struggle. You struggle in the fact that you cannot get a miracle. You want a miracle. You struggle. And don't be embarrassed, because I can't lift anymore 150 pounds over my head. I've gone down instead of up, probably because I laid off. If I would just build up, I could keep moving here. But my muscles can only now 100 pounds over my head. You know, if I keep working it, I can get up to 125, and if I get Will Franklin, he will make me do five for the haters, and I don't know what that means to this day. He should write a book, Five for the Haters. I don't know what that means. I just know what I'm doing, and I hate it. So your faith level. Now listen, this is very good. This is the mercy of God. This is incredible. Your faith level may not be at a place in which you can believe for the miracle or even speak the miracle. And Jesus makes great reference in this 8th chapter, because he's already dealt with his disciples, and they're in the boat, and they start griping about they don't have any food. And he says, hey, how many baskets were left over when I fed the 5,000? They said, 12. How many baskets were left over when I fed the 4,000? They said, 7. And then Jesus says, having eyes to see, ye not? And having ears, hear ye not? He is telling them, why are you forgetting? Why are you not believing after I've shown you? So the next thing he does, because Jesus believes in show and tell. And Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is show and tell. And the book of Acts, which is the church, is demonstration and actively doing what he showed and told us about. So he comes to Bethany, and there's a blind man. And they bring the blind man to Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand. There's something going on here. This man does not have the faith for his eyes to be open. Somebody else believes Jesus can open his blinded eyes. Somebody else brought him to Jesus. Now, don't be condemning quite yet, because you might be in this position and you're going to really rejoice and say, praise God that Jesus demonstrated this. It's a very controversial miracle, by the way. Many people argue about it. Jesus made a mistake the first time, so he had to do it twice. Jesus couldn't do it the first time, so he had to do it twice. No. This is all predicated on your faith. So instead of Jesus embarrassing him, he's blind, the people that bring him to Jesus, they say, he will heal you. But he's not ready for the miracle. So Jesus privately takes him out of town by himself, because Jesus never embarrasses anybody. And the reason why everybody else is not here and you're here, this is a private moment with nobody to be around. He's taking us out of town. Now he's going to work on his faith. Boy, when Jesus works on your faith, it's weird. It's the opposite of what you think. took the blind man by the hand, led him out of town. He gets him out of town. Jesus must have asked him, "Do you believe I can open up your eyes?" I don't know what the man said, but this is how Jesus tested his faith. You're blind. You're hearing somebody clearing their voice or their throat. As a blind man, you know, he must have something in his throat. He's getting ready to spit. By the way, this is a private thing. Jesus wouldn't do this in public. There's some things he won't do when everybody else is around. It's a private moment. I don't want to be too gross, but Jesus got a mouthful of saliva and probably says, "Do you believe you're going to see?" I think so. That's what they said anyway. They brought me to church, said there's going to be a miracle here. Watch. When healing starts, it'll get in your hand. You ever had a headache? Backache? Healing always demonstrates in your hands. Jesus spit in his eyes so he would take his hands. Now, when you're desperate for a miracle, you don't mind being spit upon. Oh, let me break it down this way. You go to a banker, the banker says, "Hey, guess what? We need to give $1 million away, and we chose you to give it away. Would you come back here in the vault? We'd like to sign the papers here. You get $1 million. And you go, "Really?" And the banker just goes, "Did you ever spit in my face again? You blankety blank blank, you blank blank blank. What the blank 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 are you doing?" Just wanted to make sure you passed the test, because they told me privately to spit in your face, and if you pass the test, you get $1 million. Spit again. You got to get to the place. There ain't nothing going to offend you. It don't matter. Just. They shall lay hands. And he wipes spit off. And Jesus asked him, "Can you see?" Here, let me lead you. There's some people coming down the road. Here, can you see? I know they're not trees. I know they're not trees. They're moving, so they can't be trees. They got to be people. I. What do you think of so far of the miracle? What's Jesus doing? Sometimes he gradually puts something into your life. You don't see the full manifestation of it, but he's trying to get you to the place. I can't see clear enough, but I'm going to tell you, I haven't seen all of my life. I can see something. Jesus wants to ask him, you believe now? Oh, yeah. Spit on me again. But this time the Bible said Jesus put his hand on him. And the Bible said the second touch. You may have a heart attack, high blood pressure. You may have some kind of thing hit you. It's spit that comes out of somewhere in life into your system. But you're still breathing. That means there's a second touch. That what the devil's trying to do, he can't do. And the Bible said anything he steals from you, you have the right to get it back double from him. And the only reason why you're poor, broke, or get sick, or you have a problem is that God, boy, I'm about to shout here. I better calm down. I better sit down right now. Somebody put a seatbelt on me, because God is so desperate to get even with the devil that he tells the devil, you get one shot at him. But if they believe that I can do a miracle, I'm gonna make you give it back to them. Double. Everybody in here ought to have fire inside of you. There ought to be something on the inside of you that says, my God, because if you're going through anything, that is a sign that you've been spit upon. I wish I could get my paid staff as excited as all of you. I wish I could get my paid staff as excited as all of you. All of you that pay your tithes and pay the staff, get it excited about the fact. It may be a private moment in your life, and Jesus will make it private between you and the doctor and your family and whatever. But I'm telling you, you have the right to say, I can see I'm going to be healed. I know God can do it, and that's all he's waiting on. And he will touch you the second time. Somebody shout the second time. You got this mic on? Got this mic on? Hello? Maybe see it for a minute. I'm going to pray the prayer miracle. I'm using this as an example, but anybody been spit upon? Going through anything? Out of nowhere, something just happened. miracle going to happen to you tonight. It's on my phone. She'll be here next Wednesday night. She's a faithful member. She pays her tithes. She's great. She got my number. She's screaming on the other end of the phone today. She sends me the text to show me the picture. I rejoice with her. You said, Pastor, that the month of May is miracles. Yeah. Pastor, when you say something, I believe it. Yeah. I just received, she took a picture of it, I just received my miracle. Here is the $50,000 check that somebody gave to me because I was believing for a miracle. Don't get jealous. Don't get jealous. God's got a $100,000 one for you. A $20,000, $10,000. Come on, miracle. Come on. Why are you sitting there? Why are you not clapping your hands? Clap! Clap! So, you may be seated. There's all kinds of miracles that are happening. So my next door neighbor comes over to me yesterday, says, I got my main miracle. I said, what is it? I'm not telling you. I want to tell the whole church. I don't know what the main miracle was. Come up here, Rick Newham, my neighbor. I don't know what this miracle is. We got to get in the light. I want the devil to watch his TV while you're doing this. Right there.
Right there.
That's good.
Right
there. No, yeah, right there. Right there. It's on. Turn it on.
Sure, it's on.
It's on.
First of all,
a little louder.
I want to thank you for warming up the crowd. Thank you.
Turn it up. Turn him up.
So I live next door to Pastor. He takes back my garbage, blows my leaves.
Now you got to tell them the reason why I do that, because I'm not coming to your house to do that. The reason why I do that is because I wanted to win him to the Lord. I wanted to get him and his family, they're all here. And I did that for you. I'd get his garbage, take it up to the front. I'd blow his leaves. All because I wanted him to come to Family Christian Center. Guess who won? Thank you. Amen. That's so funny.
So, I'm negative. Not as bad as I used to be. Thanks to Pastor. I'm sure, any of you negative in here? Well, in here you might be all jumping up and down, but when you leave here, you're probably negative. I've been in business for 47 years, and I've done a lot of things. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. Most times they don't, so it's easy to get negative. Last May, we had a miracle. My daughter had a dream to get into law school, get a job, and it happened in May.
Right, and she talked about it. There she is right there. She just returned. You probably don't tell that, but better let you tell it.
Pardon?
I'll let you tell. I'm going to tell that she just got back, but I don't know. She may be part of the miracle. I don't know.
No, that's not part of the miracle.
Well, she just got back from Spain because she's been studying over there with her law practice, and she got a miracle last year. That's what he's talking about. Stand up. She just got back from Spain. She's single. And nobody but rich young men. I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
So 13 years ago, I bought some land out in Maryville. I wanted to make a shopping center, and I wanted to make it nice. Shops like Lululemon and Neiman Marcus. I was going to make it nice on Broadway Street. It took me about a year. I wasted a lot of money. I found out that the stores didn't want to come here. So for 12 years, I've been trying to sell the land. I thought it would be no big deal, and it didn't work. Every year I pay taxes, insurance, maintenance. I just keep losing thousands and thousands of dollars. I go over to pastors. Pastor says, it's not your time, it's God's time. And I'm so tired of hearing it's God's time. So last year, when my daughter got the job, I got an offer to sell the land in May.
In May.
It fell through. Didn't happen.
And do you remember last May, anybody? I asked him, did he get his miracle? And he just said, nope. That was when he lost his land.
He didn't know it fell through when he was telling about the miracle, because I hadn't had a chance to tell him it fell through. 3 years ago, I started to buy a building in South Holland. I was working with the village in the Cook County, back and forth and lawyers, and it just wouldn't happen. Last Wednesday, when we were sitting here, this place was crazy. Pastor Phil was going crazy. Pastor Steve was going crazy. And I peeked at my phone. My wife says, what are you doing? I said, I'm looking to see if I got some good news. I'll go tell Pastor. Nothing happened. I get home, I check my email, nothing happened. Next morning, I check my email, nah. I said, well, here we go again. You know, another May miracle down the drain. Later that day, I came home, and I got an email that said, South Holland's ready to close on your land.
Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah.
On that building in South Holland.
Sure.
We're closing Friday.
Somebody, let's all thank God for that. That's great. Thank you. That's a great miracle.
That's not all.
Oh.
Sit back down. Sit
Go
back
ahead.
Down.
How many want to hear another one?
Sit back down. Let me preach just a little bit. Turn it up. Stetson. Later on in the day, I swear to you, I'll show you the email. I got an email for an offer on my land in Maryville.
Hallelujah.
For more than I was offered last year.
Oh, that's a May miracle. That's a May miracle.
So, yeah, I don't know if you heard on Sunday, but Pastor was talking about the Kentucky Derby. The horse was 80-1. He's making a big deal about it. I've been trying to buy that building for 1,000 days. And it happened. There's 365 days in a year, and it happened the day after we were here preaching. The land in Maryville, I've been trying to sell for 4,000 days. And it happened the same day.
Praise God. That's great. That's great. Thank you, Jesus.
So if something's not going on in here, I don't know what, but you can't be negative all the time.
That's a great testimony coming from Rick. Give it up for Brother Rick. No, let me tell you, that's a great testimony. Thank you. That's my baby in the Lord. You know, that's my... Yeah. If you always see a bunch of people sitting around me, I'm winning them to the Lord. You should win a bunch of your all neighbors. Hello. What a great miracle. Now, guys, can I tell on Mary? Can I tell on Rick a little bit? Mary? He is the most negative. And I worked on him every day. Can't say that, Rick. Quit being negative. Come on, it's going to work. And he's real honest. What you just saw, you won't get anything different out of him. He's very, very forthright, honest, will tell you what you think. He tells me what he thinks about the sound every service. And he loves it when you all shout. He just goes crazy. He just, man, they were with it. Our church was with it. He just loves that. Now, he's a white man that sits there, and you don't see much out of him, but he loves when all of you do it. So you can't judge people, you know, by the posture. So that for him to say what he said tonight, that is a great, wonderful testimony. That's a great testimony. And next week, I'm going to interview some more people, and you need to write down these miracles because we, people that are watching, but I want to tell you about another miracle that happened today. Well, I should talk about two miracles, but the first miracle, well, I'll talk about this other miracle, and that is we have somebody after 17 years wanting to partner with us after we have been through much turmoil in the last 6 or 7 years in a situation that we've been through. Some know, some don't know, but legally. And we are wanting to build the equestrian center. We want to get it up right away on a new property. We can't do it and couldn't do it, etc. But all of that has changed just a few days ago when this outstanding partner came out of nowhere, bank that says, we want to partner with you. We want your dreams to come to pass. We want to be with you. We love your church growth. We love your finances. We love the audits. We cannot believe that this church. And so in them partnering with us, we will start in July, hopefully. We're all going to groundbreaking to the new property. We will build the $75,000 square feet equestrian center, which will be the beginning of a footprint that will help veterans, autism, all kinds of ministries. And the writing arena is bigger than this auditorium. And the greatest thing about it, it's already paid for. It's already paid for. Somebody gave that kind of money. And for the first time, our church is becoming endowed. And we have struggled for 17 years to get to this point. And you can be very proud of that. And so let me just tell you about the miracle. It is a miracle. Sometimes I'll tell you about the whole story. It's a miracle. So the bankers are coming in next week, and I'm going to need as many ladies Friday morning at 9 o'clock to come and help me and help Yolanda and Edgar. We need some painters. We just got to make sure everything is spick and span. So when they come, they'll like everything. So at 9 o'clock to 5 o'clock, come help us. Saturday morning, 10 o'clock to 2. Just come. Just come. Wipe the dust off. Shine everything up. Second miracle. So, you'll like this, Marion and Rick, because they're the one who introduced me. My gardener, I have a gardener. Well, actually, when I bought the house 14 years ago, the gardener came with the house, and he was a precious African-American man. I mean, one of the most precious men I've ever met. And so, I couldn't fire him. I just kept him on. 6 months after he was working for me, he started coming to this church. He got saved. He got baptized. And he died, I think, about 2 years ago. And he was a precious man. He's an older man. He said, I've never seen a church like this in my life. He would tell me, he said, they told me one time that there would be a mixture of cultures that would come together at the church. He said, I never saw that before. He said, I never seen anything like it. And he was a sweet man. So then Rick had to get me another lawnmower cutter. And so I said, who's your guy? And so once a year, we
Melody likes flowers, so we have flowers in our yard. We have a little tiny garden, something we enjoy. So today, this is so great. This is going to blow your mind. Blew mine. One of the men who is the gardener, I went out. It was hot today, so I gave him a bottle of water. I said, thank you so much. I know you're being paid by your boss, but, you know, here. And I gave the other one, and they're planting flowers. And he said, Pastor Munsey? First thing I thought, oh, my God, I've been caught. Dear Lord, have mercy. Well, he didn't know this was my house. I'm in my pajamas. Really, or I'm embarrassed. Pastor Munsey? What the? Jumps up. I go to your church. I go, oh, Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. He starts jumping up and down. Said, man, I want to tell you something. You're a rock star. He just goes on, you know, like that. Hey, no, I'm not. Do I look like a rock? Look at me. I'm in my pajamas here. No, you're a rock. He said, I never got this close to you. I'll go to your church. You changed my life. I've been shot 35 times. I'm a gang leader once. I was hooked on heroin till I came to your church. He said, I was blind. My wife led me into the balcony. But one day you spoke and said, eyes are being opened. And he said, my eyes opened in the balcony when you said that. I have not been on heroin for 3 years. He said, Pastor, I'm sorry. I was a gang leader in Inglewood, California. It was transferred by the gangs to be here. He said, it's worse here than it is in Inglewood, California. I'm talking to him. I'm thinking, Pastor, I've been shot 30 some times. And then he said to me, he said, you know, it's getting better in Northwest Indiana. You know, most everybody has killed each other. Listen. He said, you can't believe how safe it is to walk on the streets now. Hammond and East Chicago, Gary. Because they've killed each other. That's what's going to happen to the South Side. If we don't get revival, it'll get better. But it's not going to be given with a policeman. They're going to kill each other. And I want to tell the African-American community, they're killing each other. And your race is important. And your culture is important. And you better get their fathers back to their house to teach them that life is important. And he told me, he said, they're killing themselves. That's how areas get better. Finally, just kill themselves. No policemen killing. Why? Because we don't respect life. Nobody teaches us that life is important. Kill, do drugs. He said, but when I came to your church, I got saved. I put the guns down. I put the heroin down. And he said, I don't care if I make money anymore. I'm just so happy. He said,
would you let me take a picture with you tomorrow? Because I brought a phone that don't take pictures. Would you let me? You. And he just goes on and on and on. You don't know who is in the house that needs a miracle. Just spoke one time, somebody's eyes are being opened. Has tattoos all over himself. So I said to him today, he said, the only thing I have is I'm trying to clean my language up, preacher. I'm so sorry. I'm getting better. I said, well, welcome to Family Christian Center. I said, I'm going to baptize you. God's going to call you. And you're going to be over our gangs. We're going to make you a minister. When you go through classes and we train you. Tears run down his face. He says, I know all the Latin kings. He goes through every gang. I'm an official and I walked away from it all. Says to me, please let me be that person. I said, you can go where I can't go and you can say things I can't say. And you can save somebody's life. Aren't you glad you go to a church where people can come in and get saved and be delivered and be healed? Miracles. I want to take the offering so that I can pray for the miracles. And I'm going to do it in just a moment. I'll tell you. I'm going to release the miracles. There's several things on the tip of my tongue that I'm going to speak over everybody in this place. Miracles. Miracles. Everybody watching me, as you begin to give right now, just let's do this in the balcony and on the main floor. Miracles. Miracles. We're going to give. I need an envelope. I have my offering ready to go. I need an envelope. I want to give my offering. There's something special about giving to God. We're not giving to an institution, we're giving to God. So while you're doing that, I'm going to give you, before I release the miracles, I'm going to tell you something. Just keep giving. 1,000 is spelled T-H-O-U-S-A-N-D. 100 is spelled H-U-N. Anyway, your phone can do it. It'll tell you. Let's give to God. Let's give our Wednesday night for you that are watching as we continue to support the kingdom. In a few weeks, I'm going to bring you the plans. I meet with the architect tomorrow, the new front of our church, the new box seats. I'll be telling you about the set as it moves back. And 2024 will be our 50th year doing Jesus of Nazareth. And we will have I have done it in 17 cities. I have built 17 sets. I have built 2 amphitheaters. And to date, we've had nearly 1 million people face-to-face see Jesus of Nazareth. And in 2024, the set will be moved back. We'll move it back. It will be bigger. It will be better. And in 2024, we will have our east wing, and we will have completed our 3-story lobby. That will be glass all the way across the front, which you will enjoy. New bathrooms that will be the best bathrooms in town. Giving. Everybody say giving. If we stay strong, we can be strong and we can go to the next level. I need as many people that will help us Friday morning. And at the information or the at the if you want to sign up, you can. But in the Friday morning, not tomorrow. Friday morning, because we have to get everything ready for all the buckets. Everybody stretch your hands, and all you watching by phone, stretch your hands. Say, in the name of Jesus, we give our tithes and we give our offerings. I'm going to say this Sunday, Mike, where's the XPs? All the XPs come right up here. All the XPs. These are just a couple of them. Come on. If you're an XP, come on up here. You all sit down so they can see behind you just for a second. You all sit down just for a second before I release the miracles. Everybody sit down. I didn't know this, that in Oak Brook, that when they went, you guys and many others, you must understand that I did not know this, and Kent told me that in Oak Brook and throughout Illinois and Indiana, they have made Family Christian Center the number one security of churches in all of the Midwest. And Bill Hybels, Oak Creek. I guess you guys went somewhere and the word is spread nationwide that the safest church you could be at is at Family Christian Center. And all of these, there's many more XPs. You don't have to worry about anything because they come in here and they practice. They run down every aisle. They can spot anybody that would do any harm, etc. And it's pretty phenomenal all that they do. They practice on Thursday nights. And they protect you and they protect your children. And we are the number one homeland security church at the top of the list in all the churches in the whole Chicagoland area. And we are teaching other churches. Give them a great big hand. Thank you, guys. Thank you. And I'm gonna do that Sunday because we got a lot of them that are not here tonight. And everybody say, Lord, bless this offering. Touch this offering. So when you see the XPs go out, they block off the hallways, they block everything. Nobody can get near. They shut the doors so your finances are safe. And there's order in how this is done. So give them a great big hand. God bless you guys. God bless you. God bless you. Singers, come. Thank you. Just come right here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Miracles. The first miracle that God wants to do tonight, there's probably going to be about five that I really feel like I can speak this. Anyone of any kind of cancer should come up here. You're going to be healed of cancer. There's going to be a miracle that's going to happen to your body. So if there's anybody that's got any kind of cancer in your body, whether it is a small cancer, large, doesn't matter. You're going to be healed. Hello, how you doing? Just right here. Thank you. You're the only one. In other words, Jesus, unless somebody else is coming, are you coming, sir? Number two, cancer. Okay. He's standing in for a family member. That's good. That's all right. That's all right. But if I do that, then everybody will come. And I just want to pray for those that have cancer. But you can stay there and believe with me. You have cancer. Yep. Don't anybody come for somebody. I'll do that in just a minute. I need to pray specific. That's all right. You guys stay there. You stay there. Believe with her and me. several years ago, a man came. He was right here. Come over here and stand right where he is, man. What's your name? You have family here? Got a friend. Thank you, friend. So he's standing right here, and I don't see Dr. Shipman here, and he was dying with cancer, and they came here, you know, they wanted us to pray. I could tell he was dying, and I actually said what I'm going to say to you. You're going to be healed of cancer tonight. Okay? So this is all verified. This is very true. So he walked out. I mean, you're in good shape. You look healthy. He was not healthy. He had an oxygen tank. And actually, the doctor sent him from community to die and said the last place you should go is Family Christian Center. So a doctor brought him here. And his wife was standing there. Now, these were not members of our church. Never met him before. Anything like that. You guys come over here. You just stand with me. Don't feel bad. Just stay there, because what you pray for others will happen to you, okay? So anyway, he actually died 7 days later. 7 or 8 days later. It's a true story. And somebody came to me and said, you know the man you prayed for that had cancer and said he was going to be healed, or he was healed that night? He died. I can tell you, man, I went through, you can't believe what I went through. I went to the TV department, said, destroy that tape of Wednesday night. Get the thing off of anywhere that nobody can get. I thought my ministry was completely over, because I had said, you're healed of cancer, okay? And I kind of waited for people to write me letters and said, hey, what about, we heard. But one thing, he was not a member of the church, so he wasn't popular. And so if he was popular, I don't know what would happen. I probably got letters and people have said to me, no, I don't know what would have happened, you know. But I was concerned about it. I was kind of embarrassed. Here I said, God is going to heal you. And I felt I was betrayed, and it didn't happen, and he died, okay? This is a true story. And Dr. Shipman can verify this. All this is verified. So about, I don't know how many weeks, or maybe it was a couple of months, I'm not sure. One of my staff members came during the day and said, such and such is here to see you. And I said, who is it? I don't know. Her name is so-and-so. I said, well, find out who she is. And she says, I'm the woman who my husband you prayed for, who had cancer, died. Well, naturally, I don't want to see her. This is true story. And I said, I don't want to see her. I, what am I going to do? I mean, this is the first time since that night that I've had anybody said anything about it, because I publicly said it to everyone. And then, you need to talk to her. So she came in, and she had a big envelope, manila envelope. And she says, I don't know you, but I know you must, you're very sincere. And you said to my husband he would not die of cancer. And I felt obligated to come and tell you that I had an autopsy done on my husband. And she actually pulls it out. It's his whole skeleton, or, you know. And she holds it up. And she's very sincere about it. She said, they did not find one trace of cancer in my husband's body. And I've come to tell you, he did not die of cancer. He had a heart attack. He had a weak heart. But she says, I want you to know there is no trace of cancer. And I want you to know that what you said, sir, even though I'm not a member of your church, it came to pass, and I felt an obligation to come and tell you. Of course, naturally, you know what I did? I said, thank you, Lord. So the gift of miracles, not me, can't do anything. The gift of miracles is at work at this moment. And I'm going to tell you that you're going to be healed. You're going to be healed. And these two gentlemen are standing in for somebody, and there's many others that probably want to do the same. But it's very interesting that when I asked for someone that has cancer, you were the only one that's here. That means God is going to heal you. So, this is a very simple thing. Just care, face me. Very simple thing. It's nothing. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to put my hand on your head. This is a very scriptural thing. Okay? I can't heal anything, but I can be obedient to God. So I ask God tonight, give me, I want miracles and I want the gift of knowledge. So he revealed to me to pray for cancer tonight. He told me, you saw me just kind of stutter here for a moment, and I waited on the Lord, and he said, I'm going to heal cancer. So that's the reason why I made the call. When I lay my hands upon you, it is only the seal, and it's only the conclusion, because I'm going to have to ask you if you'll allow me to do this. I'll lay my hands on you, and I will say, in the name of Jesus, you are healed by his stripes. Now, I must ask you, can I do that? The reason is because the Bible says you must ask or call for the elders of the church, and they lay hands upon you, and you'll be healed. If you give me the permission, then I'm going to do what God told me to do biblically. You could do the same thing just as I'm doing when you become, you know, when you're a believer, and you're going to be healed. Okay? And the confirmation. I want to tell you this too. You probably don't know who this woman is, but many people in here know who this woman is. There was a woman called Jan Crouch. She built, her and her husband, the largest Christian television network in the world, TBN. It's on all channels. She's a giant of faith, and they built the largest, until to this day, it's the largest Christian network in the world. One day I was in her presence, and she's huge, big giant in the, you know, in the kingdom. And the Lord spoke to me and said, she has not asked for somebody to pray for her. And she had cancer. And she had thousands of letters she showed me in the corner. I mean, it was stacked 3 or 4 feet tall. I'm talking about thousands of letters of people praying for her. When the Holy Spirit revealed to me, I said, Jen, have you asked somebody to pray for you? And she's a Christian. She's a believer. In fact, Benny Hinn and I were in her living room, and we're going to serve her communion that morning. And it was the first time I'd kind of been around Janet at first, you know, in the beginning of my ministry. The Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, ask her if she has been prayed for. Has she asked somebody to pray for her? She looked at me and said, no, I've not specifically asked anybody to pray for me. Now, she's a Christian. She's a believer. And everybody needs to know this. You better wake up. Just because you're a Christian doesn't automatically happen. You got to go. That's the reason why these altars are filled with elders and they got anointing oil on Sunday. You must go to them. And it is, and it's an application of showing God you're asking. So she asked me to pray for, and Benny Hinn broke in. He's a famous evangelist, and said, let's have a special service. And 3 weeks later we did, and I flew out there. And in front of 3,000 or 4,000 people, she stood on the stage and she pointed and said, would you come and lay your hands upon me? I did that. Not that I'm great. It's just a biblical understanding. Everybody listening to this? If you get sick, if you need somebody to lay hands on you, you got to ask for it. You can't wait. I laid hands on Jan. I said, be healed. In 5 days, in that time, she went to the doctor. She had cancer through her body. They took test after test. She was healed of cancer from that day forward. One more thing. When I was 22 years old, no, excuse me, it was 1977. It was 1977. I'm trying to figure out how old I was. I think I was 25, maybe. I went to Houston, Texas, and I checked myself into a hotel room. For 30 days, I did not eat. Two ministers checked on me every single day, and I laid on the floor and I prayed for 30 days. I did not eat. I was going through a change, and I was not married at the time. I was single. I could take you to the hotel today. It's still there at the Intercontinental Hotel of Houston, Texas. When I got there, on about the 29th day, the Lord gave me a word, and I was speaking in tongues, and I thought it was speaking in tongues. And he said, I kept saying sickle cell anemia, and I thought it was speaking in tongues. After the 30 days of fasting, okay, I preached at a church in Houston, Texas. It was a big church. Many people came to the altar, and I just finished my 30-day fast. And so it was a lot of unique things that happened. And there was a beautiful, precious, black African-American man, and it was mostly a white congregation. And he was the only black man that I saw in this huge 2,000 or 3,000 white congregation. And I kept praying for people saying sickle cell anemia. And he came to me after the service, said, do you know what you're saying? And I said, what do you mean? He said, you say sickle cell anemia over and over and over. I said, I'm speaking in tongues. He said, sickle cell anemia is a blood disease. And it usually is in African American, mostly, right? Am I right? And that was the first time that God spoke to me and said I would have influence over the African-American community in this nation and even in South Africa. That was the beginning. I didn't know. When he said that to me, he said, it's a blood disease. That's when God spoke to me and said, when you lay hands on people, their blood will be healed. And tonight, your blood needs to be healed. It's not good. It needs to be stronger. So not only is God going to heal you of cancer, but he's going to heal your blood. Are you ready? Will you allow me? Everybody stand to your feet. The Holy Ghost is going to do the miracle right now. Cast your hands toward her. In the name of Jesus, I lay my hands upon you. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the power of the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you are now healed of cancer. Leave, you foul disease. Come out of this body. May your blood be healed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You're healed. Somebody give the Lord, get her name. Lord, touch that cancer. Touch those people with cancer. Just stay there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All legal. There's legal stuff in here. You guys stay right there. It's all right. You stay right there. Legal. There's something legal. There's lawsuits. There's legality and relationships. There's legal stuff. It's going to court. In this legal stuff that I see also is someone who's been incarcerated, who is in jail or prison. And in this legal, whoever you are related to that person, it will be settled tonight. All all, not just that case. By the way, whoever that is, there's a divine reversal. They're going to be coming out of prison. I don't know who that is. That's somebody here. You're close to that situation. All legal. Lawsuits, legal, something legal. Whoever you are, come down here right now. God says, I'm going to settle it. Come. All legal. Whatever it is. Whatever papers, whatever thing. Come. Stand beside her. Yeah. Yeah, there's a big inheritance coming. They've been trying to stop from you getting it. It's going to come upon you. You too. It's going to happen to you. It's none of my business. It's none of my business about. I don't want to know about, but it's legal. It's documented. It's stuff. I want you to look at all of this. I want you to look at it. You believe God's revealing something here tonight? Somebody give the Lord a hand clap. There's something going to happen. Hallelujah. I want to be real careful when I say this because I don't want to get you into the flesh realm. But because you are a believer, the devil does not want you to have what's coming to you. Listen to me. Listen to me. And I'm going to say something to somebody that's here. The reason why you're not getting it is because you can't handle it. Because it'll take you to hell. And you need to tell God that will not change your conviction with God. And He will believe you. Even though people lie to God, God is a trustworthy God. He will believe. And the minute you do that, there's a breakthrough going to come. I have no idea who that is. And I'm not pointing you out. And God's not showing me who you are. So don't get nervous and say, is that me? I have no idea. Don't even want to know. Not interested. I'm just telling you, that's one of the reasons. There's a reason. And I'm going to tell everybody that's standing at this altar, every one of you tonight, this has been a private meeting with God. And I'm going to tell every one of you something. Mark it on your calendar. When is coming into your life? When? Come on, clap your hands. Show God you believe. When, whatever that means, when. I don't believe I have ever in my life called people forward for this kind of miracle. I cannot remember God ever speaking to me and telling me legally, paper, court. I prayed for people in prison. But you wonderful people here tonight, you need to know that God is in control. What God reveals, He heals. God has revealed this. Now, it's nobody's business. If you have people that are in here tonight and they're going to ask you after church, what are you going through? What are you going through? It's none of their business. And don't be asking questions like that. None of your business. Just believe that God is bringing victory to every one of these in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. So I need you to lift your hands. The Holy Spirit's going to come upon you. I prophesy. I'm going to speak in prophecy. I'm going to prophesy. In the name of Jesus. You have obeyed the call of the word of knowledge, which is a gift of the Spirit. The word of knowledge came inside of me and revealed this. Not your particular case, but legally, something legally. It's what all I got. And the Holy Spirit is saying, I am going to touch victory. There's win. And there's a many of you that are standing here. You have went through some dark days and you don't think you're going to win. And God has come to tell you tonight, I am for you. I am with you. I have revealed this. I'm going to be perfect. Put your hands down. Look straight at me. I have to be perfectly honest. I only know of one case here. You're standing in front of me. And Mama is. I only know one case here. And I didn't know you were in the audience. I didn't see you. I didn't see you guys. And I didn't. So I want to be perfectly honest because you know. Because I pray for situations. So you would naturally think, well, he saw me. So that's the reason. No. I didn't even know you were in the audience. So I don't want any of this, any of our faith to be destroyed. Okay, so I'm going to tell you something. Look at me. The reason why it hasn't come to fruition is because you've been. And guess who's done the spitting? Jesus. Can you see now? Can you see the victory now? Can you see the victory now? So take your hands and put them on your eyes. Wipe your eyes. Now lift your hand. Lift your hand. And say these words, because Jesus has just touched you. I will now be able.
I will now be able
to see.
To see
the victory.
The victory.
I couldn't see it.
I couldn't see it
before tonight.
Before tonight.
Woo! Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. 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 Whoa. Boy, I felt the Holy Ghost. Excuse me. Sorry. Like fire shut up in my bones. There's two more things. Stay right there. The Holy Ghost. You all are very strong in your faith. There's two more things. And Rick Newell, our brother, literally gave a word even though he told you of your testimony, his testimony. There are others here tonight, and some of you may be here. You also are involved in selling something. You're also involved in buying something. Come down here right now and receive this touch. Whoever you are, come right down here. Come right down here. Everybody kind of move in just a little bit. That's it. Many people are coming. A lot of people, I should say. All of you down here say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I can't wait. I can't wait. I can't wait for you to tell me. I can't wait. Come on, wave your hand and say, I believe it, I believe it, I believe it.
I believe it, I believe it, I believe it, I believe it, I believe it.
Everybody lift your hands. The buy and sell. It shall come to pass before May 30th. I don't know what day May 30th is. May, ooh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody shout May 30th.
May 30th.
Everybody say it shall come to pass.
It shall come to pass.
I want to use the word before because it can happen in the morning all the way to May 31st. Tonight, the anointing is upon you. God gave this testimony to give you faith. You will buy and you will sell. And you will give glory to God. Everybody give God the glory. One last thing. This is going to encompass about everybody, I think. But I really, really feel this stronger than I've ever felt in my life, especially with the inflation and with things that are happening around us, is only a sign that God is up to something for provision. When Peter came to Jesus and said, Jesus, we don't have money to pay our taxes. And Jesus said, go fishing. And the Bible said that Peter went fishing and caught fish that had gold in the fish's mouth. There are two parts to what I'm going to pray. And all I need you to do is step out. Just step out. You're not all going to get to get here. But this is the final thing I feel in miracles. And that is out of debt. Out of debt. Out of debt. And some of you are down here. I know you're down here too, standing already. Out of debt and increase. And God is sending fish to you that's got gold in it some way, somehow. Step out, whoever you are. Anybody who wants that, probably it's most of us. Just step out wherever you are. I know in the balcony. In fact, balcony, if you don't want, listen, balcony, if you don't want to come all the way down here, just come down to the rail. Come down to the rail, balcony. Just come down to the rail so you don't have to walk all the way. Just come down to the rail. Just come down as close as you can to the rail. And I'm sure there are people up here that I'm talking to. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody say miracles.
Miracles.
Everybody say this is not normal.
This is not normal.
Everybody say the gift of knowledge.
The gift of knowledge.
Everybody say prophecy.
Prophecy.
Say this is very biblical.
This is very biblical.
We do not give the glory.
We do not give the glory.
To Steve Munsey.
To Steve Munsey.
This is the word of the Lord.
This is the word of the Lord.
This is very biblical.
This is very biblical.
This is God.
This is God.
This is God. Thank you, Jesus. Many people are watching, and everything that I've said for you that are watching, it's happening through that camera too, so you just get ready, wherever you are. Everybody lift your hands and say, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I receive this prophecy.
This prophecy.
In May.
In May.
2022. Of increase
and the destruction
of my debt.
Of my debt.
I'm going to be very candid with all of you. By May 30th, there will be increases probably on every single part. There's going to be much increase. But let me tell you something. I want to forewarn you. Listen. When the increase comes, use your brain. God is giving you increase to pay off debt, to do things of investment. He's going to bless you. He's going to do great and mighty things for you. So everybody say, I receive the anointing of miracles.
Of miracles.
Of the word of knowledge.
Of the word of knowledge.
The word of wisdom.
The word of wisdom.
And in the name of Jesus.
And in the name of Jesus.
Now, everybody, put your hand on your heart. This is the last prayer. We're over time, but usually overtime is good. Sometimes it's not good, but it's overtime. And we don't do this every service. This is what I prophesy. Beginning tonight, all the way to the 31st, I'm going to speak three signs. I'm just going to say three signs of increase from now to May 31st. Now listen closely to this. What I see in this is only... This is a private matter with Jesus and you. He's taking you out of town. He's taking you by yourself right now. And he's privately speaking to you and says, when I give these three, whatever they are, which you will know they're increases of some kind before May 30th, it will be a sign to you that much more is coming. And that you... You be smart and remember it was God that gave it to you. And be very careful. Don't go spinning it on high heels and bling bling, and be very careful with it because there's much, much more. There's increase tonight. Many are going to get raises. There are going to be much increase. There's great things that are going to happen to you financially. And there's a big breakthrough financially for most everybody that is here. So I speak. Remember the blind man. Before I let you go, remember the blind man was brought by somebody that believed he could be healed, but did not believe he could be healed himself. Jesus took him privately away. Jesus spit in his eyes so he would reach with healing hands to wipe it away. He could not see completely, but Jesus was building his faith. Got it? There is a second touch on you. There is a powerful second anointing on you. And tonight you leave with the power of God. And when you walk out of here tonight, remember this, that when you start trying to see it, just reach up with your hands and say, Lord, I know you see it already. It may not be clear, but I'm getting to the point. Lord, you're touching me. And everybody say, in the name of Jesus,
I receive
this word.
This word.
Now look at Pastor here. Look at Pastor. What I just told you, I believe with the gift of faith that that's going to happen. I believe. I brought you to Jesus. I said, I brought you to Jesus. Do not get in a position to try to figure out what he's going to do. You're not going to figure out the spit in your eyes. It's just going to happen. So don't worry about the negative. Keep focused. And everybody say, it has been spoken over me.
It has been spoken over me.
He prophesied over me.
He prophesied over me.
I'm in agreement.
I'm in agreement.
I may not have all the faith.
I may not have all the faith.
But he has the faith.
But he has the faith.
He brought me to Jesus.
He brought me to Jesus.
Jesus will do the rest.
Jesus will do the rest.
Amen.
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 I'll be back here for one more night of miracles next Wednesday night. God bless you. Go out here with a miracle in your life.
What a night of miracles. Wasn't it great? I especially love the miracle of the young man I met today who goes to our church. Been shot 38 times, gang leader, was converted, was blind. Sitting in our service, and the Lord, I began to speak about God opening the eyes, and his eyes opened. I enjoyed that. I enjoyed, and next week you'll see the person who God blessed with a $50,000 check, was awarded $50,000. And then all the miracles you heard tonight, and then we prayed. We prayed for the second touch. We prayed it for the areas in which you heard, and I am believing. And I am continuing to believe miracles are happening even to you. I just feel very, very good about this season. I don't know if there's ever been a time in which there's been as much activity as far as spiritual things happening. And when I say that, I say it concerning Russia. Because anyone that knows anything about Bible prophecy, Russia is the North. Russia is the bear. Russia is moving south. When somebody says they'll pull up out of Ukraine, the war will end. That will be over. And it is a sad thing to be a victim in Ukraine. We have sent help ourselves there. We have given financially. We love Ukraine. But when Bible prophecy begins to unfold, those that are a victim of Bible prophecy, they suffer the consequences because the rain falls on the just and the unjust. Russia's moving. Russia's moving straight to Jerusalem, and it's not going to stop. When you begin to see all the rhetoric from Sweden and the UK Union, you begin to see it wobbling. You begin to see it happening. I pray that peace will come to Ukraine and Russia. I do. But if it's biblical prophecy, there's nothing we can do to stop it. 38th chapter of Ezekiel. It's moving. The bear has risen out of its hibernation, which brings me to this point. That the reason why things are rapidly moving and God is, can I say, quickly answering, not that he never quickly answered, but it seems like there's more manifestations of God and that maybe God is wrapping it up. It's over. How many years for it to be over? 5 years, 3 years, next week, 10 years. Anybody that's lived long enough knows that 3 years is 36 months, that's fast. 12 years, fast. Anybody that's lived over, 15, 20 years, it's moving fast. And so God is pouring out his spirit. And what I want to tell you, this is the time to plug in. This is the time to regather. This is the time to say, oh God, I want to be prepared for the miracles you have in my life. So I want to excite you about the next two Wednesday nights. I fully expect, now the last Wednesday night, Perry Stone is locked in. He is beginning to travel again, hadn't traveled since COVID, and will be here on the last Wednesday night of May. I'm doing everything I can. I've talked to Pastor Jensen Franklin, very, very busy. And it's really difficult to try to get somebody of his nature and busy as he is to come. But he said to me, I'm doing everything I can next Wednesday night. But miracles are going to happen. It's just going to be great. And I want to excite you about continuing to believe. Join me Friday morning. You can Facebook. You can get online and pray with me. pray with me and believe God. And of course, we're praying every night at 9 o'clock on the phone. You can dial the number in which we have, and there's prayer at 9 o'clock on the phone and 6 o'clock in the morning, Monday through Friday, being a part of prayer. Hope you'll pray with me, and this Sunday's going to be great. Well, I'm excited because we are in the time in which Jesus is going to visit us. And Sunday, and the service is 8:30, 10:30, 12:30. Get ready. It's not going to be any different. Here comes Jesus to give us a visitation. If you haven't given, I hope that you'll give. I hope you'll support us. I hope you'll right now just push that button and say, Pastor Steve, here's my offering. Here's my tithing. I'm so glad you're coming to us by streaming. I might say this to all of you that are watching us. Please pray for me, because we're making a major, major decision, because all of our television equipment must be replaced. Now, we have been using our television equipment in high D, or HD, I should say, for many years, and it is on its last leg. And there is a new series of cameras, and the quality that will be brought to you on your phone, your computer, your television will be unbelievable. Pray with me that Pentecost, we will be able to stand before the Lord with an offering. And could it be that we can replace all of our television equipment, streaming equipment, everything, so that we can bring the gospel to the world and to you? Pray about that. And today I thank you for giving and being faithful. Remember, there's a miracle coming to your house. And remember, yes, you can.